Hey there guys, Paul here from theengineeringmindset.com. In this video, we're going to be looking at ductwork systems for mechanical ventilation. We're going to look at how to design a basic ventilation system with a full worked example. We'll also look at how to calculate the losses through the bends, the T's, the ducts and the branches. We'll consider the shapes and the material that the ducts are made from to improve the efficiency. And then lastly, we're going to look at how to improve the efficiency and optimize the design using a freemium software for fluid flow simulation by SimScale. Methods of ductwork design. There are many different methods used to design ventilation systems, the most common ways being velocity reduction, equal friction, and static regain. We're going to focus on the equal friction method in this example, as it's the most common method used for commercial HVAC systems, and it's fairly simple to follow. So we'll jump straight into designing a system. We'll use a small engineering office as an example, and we'll want to make a layout drawing for the building, which we'll use for the design and calculations. This is a really simple building. It has just four offices, a corridor, and a mechanical room. In the mechanical room is where we're going to have the fan, the filters, the air heaters, or the air cooler. The first thing we'll need to do is calculate the heating and cooling loads for each room. I won't cover how to do that in this video. We'll have to cover that in a separate tutorial, as it's a separate subject area. Once you have these figures, just tally them together to find which is the biggest load, as we need to size the system to be able to operate at the peak demand. The cooling load is usually the highest load, as it is in this case. Now we need to convert the cooling loads into volume flow rates, but to do that we first need to convert this into mass flow rate, so we use the formula m dot equals q divided by cp multiplied by delta t, with m dot meaning the mass flow rate, the q being the cooling load of the room, CP is a specific heat capacity of the air, and delta T being the temperature difference between the design air temperature and the design return temperature. Just to note that we will use a CP of 1.026 kilojoules per kilogram per Kelvin as standard, and the delta T should be less than 10, and in this case we're going to use 8 degrees Celsius. We know all the values for this formula, so we can calculate the mass flow rate, and the mass flow rate is really just how many kilograms per second of air needs to enter that room. If we look at the calculation for room 1, we see that it requires 0.26 kilograms per second. So we just repeat that calculation for the rest of the rooms to find all the mass flow rates. Now we can convert these mass flow rates into volume flow rates. To do that, we need the specific volume or density of the air. We'll specify that the air needs to be 21 degrees Celsius, and we'll assume that it's going to be an atmospheric pressure of 101.325 kPa. We can look up the specific volume or density from our air properties tables, but I like to just use an online calculator as it's much quicker. So we just drop those numbers in and we get the density of air being 1.2 kilograms per meter cubed. You see that density has the units of kilogram per meter cubed, but we need specific volume, which is meter cubed per kilogram. So to convert that, we just take the inverse, which means to calculate the density or 1.2 to the power of minus 1. You can just do that in Excel very quickly to get the answer of 0.83 meters cubed per kilogram. Now that we have that, we can calculate the volume flow rate using the formula V dot equals M dot multiplied by V, where V dot equals the volume flow rate, M dot equals the mass flow rate of the individual room, and V equals the specific volume which we just calculated. So if we drop these values in for room 1, we get the volume flow rate of 0.2158 meters cubed per second. That is how much air needs to enter the room to meet the cooling load. So just repeat that calculation for all the remaining rooms. Now we're going to sketch out our ductwork route onto the floor plan so we can start to size it. Before we size that, we need to consider some things which will play a big role in the overall efficiency of the system. The first point we need to consider is the shape of the ductwork. Ductwork comes in round, rectangular, and flat oval shape. Round duct is by far the most energy efficient type, and that's what we're going to use in our worked example later on. If we compare round duct to rectangular duct, we see that a round duct with a cross-sectional area of 0.6 meters squared has a perimeter of 2.75 meters. A rectangular duct with equal cross-sectional area of 0.6 meters squared has a perimeter of 3.87 meters. The rectangular duct therefore requires more metal for its construction. This adds more weight and cost to the design. The larger perimeter also means that more air will come into contact with the material, and this adds friction to the system. Friction in a system means the fan needs to work harder, and this results in higher operating costs. Always use round duct where possible, although in many cases rectangular duct needs to be used as space is very limited. The second thing to consider is the material being used for the ducts. The rougher the material, the more the friction it will cause. For example, if we had two ducts with equal dimensions, volume flow rate and velocity, the only difference being the material, one is made from standard galvanized steel, the other from fiberglass. The pressure drop over a 10 meter distance for this example is around 11 pascals for the galvanized steel and 16 pascals for the fiberglass. The third thing we have to consider is the dynamic losses caused by the fittings. We want to use the smoothest fittings possible for energy efficiency. For example, use long radius bends rather than right angles, as the sudden change in direction wastes a huge amount of energy. We can compare the performance of different ductwork designs quickly and easily using CFD, or computational fluid dynamics. These simulations on screen were produced using a revolutionary cloud-based CFD and FEA engineering platform by SimScale, who have kindly sponsored this video. You can access this software free of charge using the links in the video description below, and there are for a number of different account types depending on your simulation needs. SimScale is not just limited to ductwork design, it's also used for data centers, AEC applications, electronics design, as well as thermal and structural analysis. Just a quick look through their site and you can find thousands of simulations for everything from buildings, HVAC systems, heat exchangers, pumps and valves, to race cars and airplanes, which can all be copied and used as templates for your own design analysis. They also offer free webinars, courses and tutorials to help you set up and run your own simulations. If, like me, you have some experience creating CFD simulations, then you'll know that this type of software is usually very expensive and you would need a powerful computer to run it. With SimScale, however, it can all be done from a web browser. As the platform is cloud-based, their servers do all the work and we can access our design simulations from anywhere, which makes our lives as engineers a lot easier. So if you're an engineer, a designer, an architect, or just someone interested in trying out simulation technology, then I highly recommend you check out this software. Get your free account by following the links in the video description below. Now, if we look at the comparison for the two designs, we have a standard design on the left and a more efficient design on the right, which has been optimized using SimScale. Both designs use an air velocity of 5 meters per second. The color represents the velocity, with blue meaning low velocity and red representing the high velocity regions. We can see from the velocity color scale and the streamlines that in the design on the left, the inlet air directly strikes the sharp turns that are present in the system, which causes an increase in the static pressure. The sharp turns cause a large amount of recirculation regions within the ducts, preventing the air from moving smoothly. The T section at the far end of the main duct causes the air to suddenly divide and change direction. There is a high amount of backflow here, which again increases the static pressure and reduces the amount of air delivery. The high velocity in the main duct, which is caused by the sharp turns and sudden bends, reduces the flow into the three branches on the left. If we now focus on the optimized design on the right, we see that the fittings used follow a much smoother profile with no sudden obstructions, recirculation or backflow, which significantly improves the air flow rate within the system. At the far end of the main duct, the air is divided into the two branches through a gentle curved T-section. This allows the air to smoothly change direction and thus there is no sudden increase in static pressure and the air flow rate to these rooms has dramatically increased. The three branches within the main duct now receive equal airflow, making a significant improvement to the design. This is because an additional branch now feeds the three smaller branches, allowing some of the air to smoothly break away from the main flow and feed into these smaller branches. Now that we have decided to use circular duct made from galvanized steel, we can continue with the design. Label every section of ductwork and fitting with a letter. Notice we are only designing a very simple system here, so I've only included ducts and basic fittings. I've not included things such as grills, inlets, flexible connections, fire dampers, etc. Now we want to make a table with the rows and columns labeled as per the example on screen now. Each duct and fitting needs its own row. If the airstream splits, such as with a T-section, then we need to include a line for each direction. So just add in the letters to separate the rows, then declare what type of fittings or ducts that corresponds to. We can start to fill some of the data in. We can first include the volume flow rates for each of the branches. This is easy, it's just the volume flow rates for the rooms which the branch serves. You can see on the chart I've filled that in now. Then we can start to size the main ducts. To do this, make sure you start with the main duct which is furthest away. Then we just add up the volume flow rates for all the branches downstream from this. For the main duct G, we just sum the branches L and I. For D, that's just the sum of L, I and F. And for duct A, then it's the sum of L, I, F and C. So just enter those into the table. Now, from the rough drawing, we measure out the lengths of each of the duct sections and the branches and enter this into the chart. And now we can begin to calculate the size of the ductwork. To do that, we need a duct pressure loss chart. You can obtain these from ductwork manufacturers or from industry bodies such as SIBSE and ASHRAE. I've included links to these guides in the video description below, so do check those out. These charts hold a lot of information. We can use them to find the pressure drop per meter, the air velocity, the volume flow rate, and also the size of the ductwork. The layout of the chart does vary a little depending on the manufacturer, but in this example, the vertical lines are for pressure drop per meter of duct, the horizontal lines are for volume flow rate, the downward diagonal lines are for velocity, and the upward diagonal lines are for duct diameter. We start sizing from the first main duct, which in this example is section A. To limit the noise in this section, we'll specify that it can only have a maximum velocity of 5 meters per second. We know that this duct also requires a volume flow rate of 0.79 meters cubed per second, so we can use the velocity and volume flow rate to find the missing data on the chart. We take the chart and scroll up from the bottom left until we find the volume flow rate of 0.79 meters cubed per second. Then we locate where the velocity line is of 5 meters per second, and we draw a line across until we hit that. Then to find the pressure drop, we draw a vertical line down from this intersection. In this instance, we see it comes out at 0.65 pascals per meter. So add this figure to our table. As we are using the equal pressure drop method, we can also use this pressure drop for all the duct lengths, so fill these in too. Then, coming back to the chart, we scroll up again and align our intersection with the upward diagonal lines to see that this requires a duct with a diameter of 0.45 meters. So we add that to the table also. We know the volume flow rates and the pressure drop, so we can now calculate the values for section C and then also the remaining ducts. For the remainder of the ducts, we need to use the same method. On the chart, we start by drawing a line from 0.65 pascals per meter. We draw this line all the way up. Then we draw another line across from where our required volume flow rate is. In this case, for section C, we require 0.21 cubic meters per second. At this intersection, we draw a line to find the velocity, and we can see that it falls between the lines of 3 and 4 meters per second, so we need to estimate the value. In this case, it seems to be around 3.6 meters per second, so we add that to the chart. Then we draw another line on the other diagonal grid to find our duct diameter, which in this case is around 0.27 meters, and we'll add that to the table also. So just repeat that last process for all the remaining ducts and branches until the table is complete. Now find the total duct losses for each of the ducts and branches. It's very easy and simple to do, just multiply the duct length by the pressure drop per meter of 0.65 pascals per meter, and do that for all the ducts and branches on the table. Now we can start on the fittings. The first fitting we'll look at is the 90 degree bend between ducts J and L. For this, we look up our loss coefficient from the bend from the manufacturer or from the industry body. Again, link to the video description below for these. In this example, we can see the coefficient comes out at 0.11. We then need to calculate the dynamic loss caused by the bend changing the direction of flow. For that, we use the formula CO multiplied by rho multiplied by V squared divided by 2, where CO is our coefficient, rho is the density of the air, and V is the velocity. We already know these values, so if we drop these figures in, then we get an answer of 0.718 pascals, so just add that to the table. The next fitting we'll look at is the T which connects the main duct to the branches. We'll use the example of the T with the ID letter H between G and J in the system. Now for this, we need to consider that the air is moving in two directions, straight through and also turning off into the branch. So we need to perform calculations for both of these directions. If we look at the air traveling straight through first, we find the velocity ratio first using the formula velocity out divided by velocity in. In this example, the air out is 3.3 meters per second and the air in is 4 meters per second, which gives us an answer of 0.83. Then we perform another calculation to find the area ratio. This uses the formula diameter out squared divided by diameter in squared. In this example, the diameter out is 0.24 meters and the diameter in is 0.33 meters. So if we square them, we would get 0.53. Now we look up the fitting we're using from the manufacturer or the industry body. Again, links in the video description below for those. In the guides, we find two tables. The one you use depends on the direction of flow. We're using the straight direction, so we'll okay that one, and then we look up each ratio to find our loss coefficient. Here, you can see both values we calculated fall between values listed in the table, so we need to perform a bilinear interpolation. To save time, we'll just use an online calculator to find that. Links to the site are in the video description below. So we fill out our values and we find the answer of 0.143. Now we calculate the dynamic loss for the straight path through the T using the formula CO multiplied by rho multiplied by V squared divided by 2. If we drop our values in, we get the answer of 0.934 pascals, so add that to the table. Then we can calculate the dynamic loss for the air which turns into the bend. For this, we use the same formulas as before, velocity out divided by velocity in, to find our velocity ratio. We take our values from our table and use 3.5 meters per second divided by 4 meters per second to get 0.875 for the velocity ratio. Then we find the area ratio using the formula diameter out squared divided by diameter in squared. And we use 0.26 meters squared divided by 0.33 meters squared to get 0.62 for the area ratio. Then we use the bend table for the T section. Again, it's between the values listed in the table, so we have to find the numbers using bilinear interpolation. We drop the values in to get the answer of 0.3645 pascals, so just add that to the table too. Now repeat that calculation for the other T's and fittings until the table is complete. Next, we need to find the index run, which is the run with the largest pressure drop. It's usually the longest run, but it could also be the run with the most fittings. We find it easily by adding up all the pressure losses from start to the exit of each branch. For example, to get from A to C, we lose 5.04 pascals. For A to F, we lose 8.8 pascals. For A to I, we lose 10.56 pascals. And for A to L, we lose 12.5 pascals. Therefore, the fan we use must overcome the run with the highest loss, that being A to L with 12.5 pascals, this being the index run. To balance the system, we need to add dampers to each of the branches to ensure equal pressure drop through all to achieve the design flow rates to each room. We can calculate how much pressure drop each damper needs to provide simply by subtracting the loss of the run from the index run. A to C is 5.04 pascals, which means that branch C would need a damper providing 7.46 pascals. A to F is 8.8 pascals, which means that branch F would require a damper providing 3.7 pascals. And A to I is 10.56 pascals, meaning that duct I would require a damper providing 1.94 pascals. And that is our ductwork system. We'll do another video covering additional ways to improve efficiency in ductwork systems, but unfortunately we've run out of time in this video. Okay guys, that's it for this video. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this and it has helped you. If so, please don't forget to like, subscribe and share, and also check out SimScale software. You can follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Google+, as well as our website, theengineeringmindset.com. Once again, thanks for watching.